Hi there, I'm Anna Seisling with Great Lakes Now, and joining me today is Dr. Karen Murchie, Director of Freshwater Research at the Shedd Aquarium. Dr. Murchie, it's so great to be in conversation with you. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me, Anna.
So we are talking today about suckers. For someone who's never heard of suckers, tell us a little bit about what those are.
Suckers are really a group of fishes, and there's a number of species that fall into the sucker category. But collectively, they're the most abundant group of migratory fishes in our Great Lakes. So a couple of species that are really common here are white suckers and long-nosed suckers. And the reason that they are called suckers is because they have these really amazing, fleshy, bumpy lips that are on the bottom of their faces. And they use those lips to feed on things on the bottom of the rivers and lakes. And they'll eat things like bugs, algae, and plants. And usually they're around 18 inches long.
Now I want to talk a little bit, though, about this research paper that you worked on that kind of showcased the importance of suckers to Great Lakes watershed health, ecosystem health. Talk us through that.
Yeah, so even though I mentioned suckers are our most abundant group of migratory fishes in the Great Lakes, we still don't know that much about them. But one thing that is known is that in the springtime, these fish are native to all five of our Great Lakes, and we call them the wildebeest of the Great Lakes because they make these incredible migrations in the spring. So they'll leave the lake and go to a tributary of any size. It could be a small creek or a stream or a larger river, and they move in there to spawn in the spring. And so you're going to get fish anywhere from like hundreds to thousands and even tens of thousands of these fish in one area. Actually, in one tributary in Lake Superior, there were researchers that counted over 82,000 individuals of like white and long-nosed suckers at once. So we want to fill in some information gaps because we know these animals are really important for healthy fisheries in the Great Lakes. So, and we wanted to know, what is it that drives the suckers into the creeks to spawn? Is it a water temperature cue? Is it a flow cue? What are they responding to? So we basically gathered a network of volunteers across Illinois, Wisconsin, and Michigan, along both the western side of Lake Michigan and south shore of Lake Superior, to help document when do they see suckers in the creeks. And so essentially, we outfitted all of our volunteers with polarized sunglasses and data sheets, and they had some training of what to look for suckers, and they would document when the fish showed up in the creeks to spawn. And essentially, using the first 7 years of the data, so data collected from 2017 through 2023, we looked at all of the information, the data that came from our data loggers, collecting environmental variables, and paired it with the data on when the suckers were present in all of these different tributaries. And we figured out there was a very distinct temperature cue that the suckers were responding to. And that was 6.3 degrees Celsius, which is about 43.3 Fahrenheit.
You know, in the process of putting together this paper and sort of sifting through all the findings, was there anything that really stood out to you or was especially surprising?
Well, one thing that was a little bit surprising is how much lower of a temperature threshold our study found. So that 6.3 degrees Celsius or 43.3 Fahrenheit was a lot lower than some of the literature that had been published in the past on sucker migrations. Now, mind you, those other studies usually only incorporated information from a couple of locations. So that could be part of the, the reason why our findings were lower. But I think, you know, ultimately that was a really big component for the information.
Are there any final words of wisdom or tidbits or takeaways, whether it's about the research paper or just about suckers or anything else in the Great Lakes that you want to share and leave our audience with?
I would say if you are looking for a way to contribute to science in your area. There's so many different local organizations that might have other types of participatory science programs. Maybe it's monitoring water quality or looking at pollinators around you, or documenting bat sightings or birds. I would say if you're interested in something like that, get involved, because it really does make a difference. And of course, too, for conservation to be effective, it's going to be most effective when the public is out there advocating for animals and their environments to be good and healthy, because healthy environments for them means healthy environments for us.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and check out our YouTube channel for even more Great Lakes Now. See you out on the lakes.